In this lecture, we will discuss another term as power spectral density, or basically power spectral density of a random process. So, in simple sense, the power spectral density of a random process is actually the Fourier transform of an autocorrelation function. And if Rx of tau is actually the autocorrelation function of the random process x of t. If x of is a random process, then its autocorrelation function is represented as Rx of tau. Then its Fourier transform is represented by S x of f. Then this S x of f is known as the power spectral density. So I can write a mathematical equation for that. Power spectral density S of f in frequency domain. So up to this point we discussed only time domain. Now we are going to the frequency domain concept. So this is in the frequency domain. In frequency domain, the power spectral density you can write like this: integral minus infinity to infinity. So it is a Fourier transform of autocorrelation function. So Rx of tau into e raised to minus j 2 pi f, and here the variable is tau and d tau. Okay, so this expression will give you the power spectral density. Okay, actually the Fourier transform of the autocorrelation function. Now, the reverse also we can write. If you know the power spectral density, the inverse Fourier transform will give you the autocorrelation function. So Rx of tau, you can also find from the power spectral density, that is integral minus infinity to infinity, S of f in the frequency domain, e raised to j 2 pi f tau, and the variable is f. So this is the inverse Fourier transform equation. So the inverse Fourier transform of S of f will give you the autocorrelation function. See, these two equations are commonly known as Einstein-Wiener-Kinch relationship. Okay, this is a very important relationship for a signal processing concept. Okay, because we can find the spectral component of noise by using this particular relationship. Now we'll discuss some important properties of power spectral density. The first property state that S of zero, that is power spectral density, if you evaluate at zero frequency, okay, you will get area under the autocorrelation function curve. So we can easily derive this because we know that the relation, it is integral minus infinity to infinity, Rx of tau into e raised to minus j 2 pi f tau d tau. If you substitute f is equal to 0 in this particular equation, you will get this particular relation. So the physical meaning of this particular relation is that at zero frequency value, okay, at zero frequency, f is equal to 0 is equal to the total area under the graph autocorrelation function. So this is Rx of tau. So maybe Rx of tau is a function like this. And if you find the area of this particular function, maybe from minus A to A, and if you find the area of this particular curve, it will be equal to the zero frequency value or spectral component at DC. Okay, what are the different DC frequency components? So that's the first property. And the second property is that the mean square value. Mean square value means expected value of x square of t is known as a mean square value. So this is the mean square value, x square of t is equal to the total area under the graph of a power spectral density. Okay, here we need to use the second equation, Rx of tau is integral minus infinity to infinity S of f e raised to j 2 pi f tau df. So If you substitute tau is equal to 0 in this particular equation, you will get rx of 0. Okay. So, which is simply integral minus infinity to infinity s of f df. And this rx of 0, that's autocorrelation function, is normally defined as rx of tau is, we can define as expected value of x of t plus tau into x of t. And if tau is equal to 0, you will get the mean square value. Okay. So, the third property state that the power spectral density of a stationary process is always a non-negative quantity for all value of f. So, s of f will get a positive value in all values of f. Okay. The fourth property state that power spectral density of a real valued random process is an even function of frequency. So, spectrum will be symmetrical about the axis, okay, about the y-axis. So, the power spectral density will be an even function. So, it will be something like this with respect to the y-axis. Okay, another property related to power spectral density is that the normalized power spectral density. So, S of F is a power spectral density, and if you take the total of that, that's a total power. If you integrate from minus infinity to infinity, you will get the total power. And if you divide with total power, you will get a quantity which is, the behavior is almost similar to that of a power spectral density, sorry, probability density function. Okay. So that is normalized value. The maximum value will be 1 when you divide with the total power. Okay. So the behavior is almost similar to a probability density function. So another point which is related to this is that if there is a linear time invariant system, okay, and assume that this is the input power spectral density, S of f is represented as the input power spectral density, and the impulse response of the system is represented as H of f, then the output power spectral density we can evaluate by using the relation modulus of H of f the whole square into S of f. Okay. So input power spectral density into the square of impulse response of the system will give you the output power spectral density. So this is the output power spectral density, and this is the input power spectral density. So this relation is also useful when you consider this LTI systems. Now we can discuss one problem related to this. So consider a sinusoidal signal x of t, or a random process x of t, a cos 2 pi of ct plus theta, and theta is a random variable and it is uniformly distributed over the interval minus pi to pi. Find the power spectral density. Okay, so we need to find the power spectral density. So here it is given that theta is uniformly distributed. So, if it is uniformly distributed, we can draw the power spectral, sorry, probability density function like this. It's from minus pi to pi. So, this is minus pi and this is pi, and it is uniformly distributed. It's 1 by 2 pi, pi minus minus pi. So, this will be the standard form of the uniformly distributed theta over the interval minus pi to pi. So you can write this f of theta like this. It's 1 by 2 pi for the duration minus pi theta less than pi and 0 otherwise. So we got the probability density function. Now we can find the power spectral density. So in order to find the power spectral density, we need to find the autocorrelation function. Okay. So for the signal x of t, a cos 2 pi fc t plus theta is the random process. We already discussed the autocorrelation function of this particular problem. So please watch the previous lecture. In this particular lecture, I will directly write the autocorrelation function. I will just write the step how we will write this. So, autocorrelation function Rx of tau can be written as expected value of x of t plus tau into x of tau. So, by using this relation, you can find the autocorrelation function. The time being, I will not elaborate this particular step because we already done that. So please watch the previous lecture how to find the autocorrelation function of this particular step. Now I will use directly the result here. So it's a square by 2 cos 2 pi fc tau. So this is the autocorrelation function of the given signal, which is already discussed in the previous lecture. So please watch the previous lecture, which is related to the correlation concept, autocorrelation concept. So please watch the previous lecture video for the result. Now I will start from this particular point. If the autocorrelation function is available, now we can find the power spectral density by simply finding the Fourier transform of that autocorrelation function. So this is the general equation, Rx of tau into e raised to minus j 2 pi f tau d tau. So here Rx of tau is we already discussed, and here you can substitute that. And if you substitute this integral minus infinity to infinity, it's a square by 2 cos 2 pi f c tau into e raised to minus j 2 pi f tau d tau. Okay, and here you can see that this variable used in this particular equation is a square by 2 integral minus infinity to infinity cos 2 pi fc tau e raised to minus j 2 pi f tau d tau. Actually, we need to find the Fourier transform of cos signal. So either you can express this particular term in exponential term, but we already discussed the Fourier transform of this particular signal in another way. That is, the Fourier transform of 1 is del of f. So this cos 2 pi f c t can be written as cos 2 pi f c tau can be written as e raised to j 2 pi fc tau plus e raised to minus j 2 pi fc tau by 2. Okay. So there will be two terms. So by using the frequency shifting property, we know that the Fourier transform of 1 is del of f, then 1 into e raised to j 2 pi fc tau will be simply the shifted version f minus fc. So here is a 1 by 2, so we can put 1 by 2. And similarly, for the second term, it's 1 by 2 e raised to minus j 2 pi fc tau. So the Fourier transform of this particular signal will be del of f plus fc. So we are applying the frequency shifting property, because if there is a signal x of t and the transform is x of f, by applying the frequency shifting property, x of t into e raised to minus j 2 pi f0 t can be written as x of f minus, or if it is minus, we can write f of f plus 0. So by using the frequency shifting property, we can find the Fourier transform of cos. So actually, we need to combine these two results. So the Fourier transform of cos 2 pi f c tau will be 1 by 2 del of f minus fc plus 1 by 2 del of f plus fc. So in this particular expression, is there is a constant also, a square by 2. Okay, this is a constant, a square by 2. So we can put that also. So a square by 2 here and a square by 2. Here also it's a square by 2. So we can plot the spectrum like this. This is f. This is a function, and here it is fc, here it is minus fc. So we can draw two impulse signal, one is at fc So a square by 4 into del of f minus fc here. And on the left side, it's a square by 4 del of f plus fc. Okay. So this is spectral power spectral density diagram of the given signal. Okay. So we need to do one more step in this particular cell. We need to find the autocorrelation function, then we need to evaluate. So actually I just skipped one portion here because we already completed that portion in the previous lecture. So first watch the previous lecture how to find autocorrelation function, and then we can evaluate the power spectral density. Okay, thank you.